String templates aim to rectify both of these problems. They make inserting variables and expressions into strings much easier. You can limit the object graph's depth and the number of internal references, as well as array size and input stream length. Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nicola Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today I have another JavaOne inspired mix of topics for you, namely string templates, the deserialization filter, and JavaFX 19. Like last episode, where I talked about sequence collections and pure functions, all links are in the description, even some that don't exist yet. Other than that, be sure to check out oracle.com/JavaOne, and I'll hopefully see you in Las Vegas, October 17th to 20th. Ready?
Nope, not yet. Nicola in the editing room here and... No, I'm not going to turn the camera on. Because I'm not wearing pants. I'm working from home. Who wears pants for that? Anyway, if you get a ticket for JavaOne, use code INSIDEJAVA, all caps, no spaces, for a hefty $400 discount. Now we're ready.
Then let's dive right in. Let's start with something very cool that Java will hopefully get next year and that we briefly talked about in the recent OpenJDK Q&A. String templates. When you have variables and want to put them into a string, Java offers various ways to do that, for example, concatenation with a plus, or calling string format or message format. They're all a bit cumbersome though, but that's not even their main drawback. In most cases, we're not creating text for people to read, but structured text for other systems like HTML, JSON, SQL, etc. And blindly concatenating strings and variables can not only easily create invalid strings, in cases like SQL, it can even lead to vulnerabilities. String templates aim to rectify both of these problems. They make inserting variables and expressions into strings much easier by introducing a syntax to do just that. When creating a one-line string or a text block, simply use / curly brace as opening and just curly brace as closing delimiter for the expression you want to embed. Using the otherwise illegal sequence / curly brace ensures that no existing string is suddenly interpreted as an interpolation and serves as an easy differentiator between strings and string templates. Because here's the thing. Such a stringy looking construct won't actually be an instance of string, but of templated string. To turn a templated string into a regular string, you need a policy, and that policy will be domain specific. Dealing with JSON, use a JSON policy. Dealing with SQL, use an SQL policy, and so on. The policy will be able to validate the string and make sure it's formed as expected. And even better, it doesn't have to return a string. When you're already parsing JSON or SQL to validate it, why not turn it into a JSON node or an SQL statement? Right, no reason not to. So policies allow that as well. I'm pretty excited about that feature, and at JavaOne, Gavin Bierman and Jim Lasky from the Java Platform Group will tell us all about it in their talk, String Template Pondering. There are quite a few sessions on security, but the one I want to recommend the most is the Java Security Q&A with JPG security experts Sean Mullen and Brett Wetmore. If you have any questions regarding security in Java, be sure to ask them there. But there are a lot of other promising talks as well. For example, Brian Vermeer's Deserialization Exploits in Java, Why Should I Care? I leave it to him to explain why you should, but assuming you do, I can show you a little bit what you can do against them. Brian will fill in the details. Java 9 introduced a deserialization filter, a mechanism that you can use to limit what byte streams will be deserialized. You can create allow lists and deny lists for class names and class name patterns. You can limit the object graph's depth and the number of internal references, as well as array size and input stream length. If an input stream violates these requirements, it will be rejected, and often quickly. You can statically configure the filter for all deserializations with the system property JDK serial filter or the security property of the same name in the JDK file conf-security-java-security. Alternatively, you can dynamically create object input filter instances at runtime and set them on the respective object input stream instances. Since Java 17, you can also configure a JVM-wide filter factory to reach those places where you don't control the object input stream and that are tough to configure with the global option. With it, you can create filters specifically for the context in which they will be applied. If your app uses serialization, I recommend to closely read the secure coding guidelines and also attend Brian's talk, there are links to both below. Other practical talks on the topic of security are Security Vulnerabilities for Java Developers by Okta's Brian Demers and Secure Coding Guidelines for Java SE by JPG's Chris Rees. To get a glimpse behind the scenes, check out Weijun Wang's and Sean Mullen's session Evolving the Security of the Java Platform. There will be tons of talks on Java performance, from ZGC, twice actually, to G1, from the Vector API to a general performance benchmarking introduction from JDK Flight Recorder to Micrometer. and almost all of them by the folks working on and improving these very technologies day in, day out. So if you have any questions about these, this is the place to ask them. As an ardent Linux user, I'm living in the perpetual year of Linux on the desktop, and so I'm glad that Java's not standing still there either. JPG's desktop veteran Kevin Rushforth will explain in JavaFX 19 and beyond how the desktop technology improved in recent releases. There's a number of new features and improvements. JavaFX Media now has support for H.265, that's a codec important for 4K videos. JavaFX WebView now supports transparent backgrounds, and there are new convenience methods that make JavaFX more approachable. But the one I want to focus on here is the new support for creating derived bindings directly from observable value. Say you're creating an editor for an employee instance and it has a salary slider. At that point, you probably have an observable for the current employee you're editing and another for the salary slider, but you want to bind them in a way that when the employee changes, the salary slider is bound to the new employee's salary. This is where derived bindings come in. Observable value gets methods map and flatmap that allow you to create new observables for specific properties of a value. Beyond this talk, Kevin will give a more general one called building and deploying Java client desktop applications with JDK 17 and beyond, together with JPG's Phil Race. And there'll be another one on JavaFX by Paul and Gail Anderson. To better understand how to ship such apps, check out Alexei Semenyuk's talk, JPackage, Packaging Tool for Java Applications. And if you're a macOS enthusiast, don't miss Project Lanai, new graphics pipeline for macOS. I'm the first to admit that I don't know much about cloud stuff, but if I wanted to change that, I don't think I want to though, JavaOne would be the place to do that. Graham Rochea from the Graal team will give a talk Zero to Hero, where he live codes microservices from IDE to cloud with Graal, VM and Micronaut. That would probably be a good introduction. As would Modern Java App Development in the Cloud by Rustam Mehmandarov and Mats Oppheim from Computas, where they talk about MicroProfile, Quarkus and serverless. For the more advanced, there's delightful integration tests with test containers by Atomic Jar's Oleg Shelyalev and Secrets of Performance Tuning Java on Kubernetes by Bruno Borges from Microsoft. And since I love podium discussions, I also want to recommend the Java in Containers Birds of a Feather session with JPG's Larry Cable and Eoy Lam, where they will discuss challenges with tools like Docker, Podman or Kubernetes, as well as practices that can help you solve them. And that's it for today on the Inside Java Newscast. Don't forget to check out oracle.com/java1, and I hope to get to see you in Las Vegas in October. Other than that, do all the YouTube things. I'll see you again in 2 weeks. So long!